All right, hey AP Chemistry. So I'm on page 10 of your Unit 3, Part 3 notes. And I did write a little bit of note as a continuation from my last video. But for density of gases, there was a question about what happens if temperature increases. Now, do you see how temperature's in the denominator? If this denominator gets bigger, that means my output number is going to be smaller, so a decrease in density. By the way, this is why or how hot air balloons float and work on air. When you put on the fire or the flame, you are lowering the density of the gas particles and they float on air. And then the opposite, if I have pressure, since pressure's in my numerator, if I increase my pressure, my output of density will also increase. And so make sure you kind of know that, because this might be AP questions for you to kind of understand. And so now I'm going to get into the last thing in our notes, which is gas mixtures and partial pressures. So something that's very important to know is that the pressure of a mixture of gases is the sum of all the individual pressures of the gases. So if I want the total pressure and I have like a bunch of different gases, if I add up all their individual pressures called partial pressure, that's known as a total pressure. This is Dalton's law of partial pressures, and he also used this concept of like the mole fraction. And so this is the Greek letter chi. It's spelled chi. Chi is a mole fraction. You will need to know how to calculate this. If I have a bunch of different gases and I know or I don't know their individual moles, if I have the moles of A over the total moles of all the different gases, that's known as the mole fraction. And I could relate the mole fraction to the total pressure. Here's a very important equation here. If I take the mole fraction of the gas in a mixture, so let's just say I had like three gases here, A, B, and C, and it's 0.1 atmospheres, 0.2 atmospheres, and 0.5 atmospheres. All right, I have these three gases, right? I'm gonna put some particles in here. I have these three gases. Now, if I were to open the container and all of them would flow into each other, the total pressure would be equal to 0.1 plus 0.2 plus 0.5 atmosphere, which would be 0.8 atmospheres. That's P total. And this 0.1 atmosphere is the partial pressure of A, this 0.2 is the partial pressure of B, and this 0.5 is the partial pressure of C. Partial pressure is the individual pressure a gas is giving you. Now, Dalton said that we could relate the moles to the partial pressure. So, like, if I had one mole of A, and then maybe I had two moles of B, and then I had five moles of C, I could calculate mole fraction of A by doing the moles of A, which according to my little example here would be one mole of A, over the total moles would be 1 plus 2 plus 5. So 1/8 would be equal to what they call the mole fraction. And what you could do is you could take this mole fraction and multiply it times the total moles to be able to get the individual partial pressure of the gas. And I'm gonna do that. So let's say I know my P total is 0.8, I'll do it down here, right? If I want the partial pressure of A, I could do chi A, which is 1/8, times 0.8. And guess what I get? 0.1 atmospheres, which is what I gave you in the beginning as well. So if I take the mole fraction, which is the moles of one over the total moles of all of the gases present, and I multiply it times the total pressure, I'll get my partial pressure. And so what's very important to see is the partial pressure of each gas and mixture of gases in a container depends on the number of moles of that gas. The total pressure is the sum of the partial pressures. More moles of gas, higher partial pressure, and total pressure. So this is a new and very important equation for us to know. And you're given these two equations on the AP exam, so I would give them to you too. So let's look at an example. So it says mixtures of helium and oxygen are used in scuba diving tanks to help. Oh, this is a challenging one. Let's back up for a moment and let's do 17. It says the partial pressure of oxygen was observed to be 156 torr in air, with a total atmospheric pressure of 743 torr. So I have the partial pressure of O2 is 156 torr, and the total pressure It's 743 torr. And it says calculate the mole fraction of O2 present. Well, I have this equation before that says PA is equal to mole fraction times P total. PA is equal to mole fraction of A times P total. Technically, I could rearrange this and say PA over P total is equal to my mole fraction. So what I could do is, plugging and chugging, I could take my partial pressure of oxygen, put it over my total pressure, and that's going to give me my mole fraction of O2. And so I'll do 156 torr over 743 torr. And notice how I don't have to use atmospheres because I could cancel out my torrs. And I get 156 divided by 743. And we get our predicted answer that is on the bottom of the page, 0.21. And there's no units. So my mole fraction is 0.210. So I could use partial pressure and total pressures to solve for mole fraction. Okay, here's another sample question. It says the mole fraction of nitrogen in air is 0.7808. Calculate the partial pressure of N2 in air when the atmospheric pressure is 760 torr. So atmospheric pressure is like saying the total pressure. Atmospheric pressure is all the pressure that I possibly can have. So P total is 760 torr. And it says the mole fraction of nitrogen is equal to 0.7808. I already have an equation that says partial pressure is equal to mole fraction times P total. I could plug this in and say P of N2 is equal to mole fraction of N2 times P total. So all I have to do is do 0.7808 times 760 torr. And I will get my predicted answer here, 0.7808 times 760, and I get 593 torr. Okay, so this is different ways of using the Dalton's Law of Partial Pressures or the equation that I gave you to solve for the partial pressure or total pressure. Sample question 16 is a challenging AP chemistry question. For this one, you're going to have to use P1V1 equals P2V2. And then once you get the values of P2, you're going to add them together. So here's an answer key. And this, I'll make this a challenging question. So you could look at this later. But I want to end on page 12 talking about water displacement and how to calculate the pressure in a mixture. So a typical laboratory setup is collecting a gas, like let's say there's a reaction mixture here, is collecting a gas over water. And what's very important is here's my reaction mixture. It's giving me some gas particles that are putting in here, but I'm collecting it over a beaker of water. And the water also has vapor or water vapor present on top of the liquid phase. And so if I want to figure out the pressure of my unknown gas, it's going to be equal to. I have to, if I add the pressure of my unknown gas or the gas that's produced, if I add it to water, that's my total pressure, right? And so look in here, I have P of my gas and P of H2O. And the only way they're able to exist is if they're equal to P total, which is typically the atmospheric pressure. Okay, and now you're able to, you could easily solve for P of H2O designated by a table like this. If I know that the temperature is like 25 degrees Celsius, then the temperature pressure, the vapor pressure of H2O is going to be 23.8 millimeters of mercury. If it's like 90 degrees, the vapor pressure of water is going to be 525.8 millimeters of mercury. Okay, and then the P total is the barometric pressure that they give you that day. This is just like Dalton's Law, which is the pressures of gases in a mixture, but instead of our mixture is I have a reaction mixture. So again, let's say I had zinc and hydrochloric acid react and I make a gas. The gas goes through the tube, underneath the tube, and then ends up above water. Now, this is not in a vacuum. I have some water particles in here, and I have my product particles, and I'm able to figure out the pressure of the water particles in here using the vapor pressure from a table. So let's end by doing a quick example. right? So it says I have this reaction to potassium chlorate. It's heated and I get potassium chloride and oxygen. It says the oxygen produced was collected by displacement of water at 22 degrees Celsius and a total pressure of 754 torr. So that's my total pressure, P total. The volume of the gas collected was 0.65 liters, and the vapor pressure of water at 22 degrees Celsius is 21 torr. Nice. It says calculate the partial pressure of O2 in the gas collected and the mass of KCl3 in the sample that was decomposed. I'll do that later. But let's do the partial pressure of O2. This is collecting a gas over water, and we call this water displacement. Just like I have it on page 12. So I know I'm going to have to use this equation. So P total is equal to P of the gas that's produced, which is O2, plus P of H2O. Now it told me that the total pressure in the room was 754 torr. So 754 torr. I don't know what the pressure of oxygen gas is because I have to figure it out. And it also told me that at 22 degrees Celsius that this reaction mixture was held under, that the pressure of water is 21 torr. So if I want to solve for P of O2, I just have to subtract 21 torr from both sides. And if I do this, I'll get my partial pressure of O2 being 733 torr. Now, answering the rest of this question deals with stoichiometry and using PV equals nRT, but I'm going to stop this here. So, this was just an example of how I could use Dalton's law of gas mixtures to solve for the pressure of one of the gases. So, again, going all the way back to page 10, make sure you know that if I have a bunch of different gases in a box, the sum of their pressures is going to be equal to the total pressure. And then I could calculate mole fraction by doing pressure of one times the mole fraction is P total. And if I want to calculate mole fraction, actually, if I know the moles or the masses of all of the gases and substances, I can convert those to moles. The moles of the one that I'm talking about over the total moles present is going to be equal to my mole fraction of whatever I'm talking about. All right, so this was another elongated video talking about the last thing in this notes packet, which is gas mixtures and partial pressures. Make sure you look back at or replay if you need to, or slow it down, my explanations. You are going to have to know how to use these equations, and we'll eventually get to a little bit more complicated stuff where what if I don't give you the pressures and I give you volumes and I figure out what's my final pressure? Okay? Alrighty, so if you have any other questions or concerns about gas mixtures and partial pressures, let me know, and we're going to do more of this in class.